I really didn't know what to expect these many years ago when Jeff Donaldson approached me about joining a black art group. At that point, I wasn't really interested in joining anything, and I told him I wasn't a joiner, so. He said, well, there are a couple of dudes that you know that are gonna be there. Robert Page, who I see out there, and Wadsworth, Jarrell. So I said, okay, well, they're pretty cool dudes, so I'll come and see what they have to say. Anyway, one meeting led to another, and to another, and another meeting. And it reached a point where somebody said, well, maybe we should have refreshments at our meetings. So I knew then that they were serious. And that was one way of getting commitment, with the promise of refreshments every week. And this is a confession that I have to make, that I said, I looked at Jeff after one of the meetings, and I said to myself, he wants to use us as guinea pigs, because he's working on his doctorate at Howard. I mean, not Howard, at Northwestern. And that's what people work on doctorates do. They get a bunch of people together. Anyway, as we met, and I could get a sense of what our responsibilities were, what everybody wanted to do. And we kind of like pitched ideas into a hat, into a reservoir. And one of the ideas that became part of the philosophy was the concept of mimesis at midpoint. Now that's a mouthful, and you know, it's something that I've been wrestling with ever since. It has to do with abstraction and reality. The question is, well, what's midpoint between abstraction and reality? If there's a scale that you use and pull it from one side to the other, what point is midpoint? The very first painting that I brought in for review, and those of you who were given a sheet of paper and a pencil will be able to participate in what it was like to be at an AfriCOBRA meeting. The very first painting that I brought in is, you have one of the slides, the peanut lady. Has to do with, is a very simple subject. There's an image, and you don't draw too many conclusions about it, except that it's a woman sitting on a chair with a bag of with a cart full of her bags of peanuts. That kind of like formed a pattern for everybody who became a member at one of the meetings. We all brought in something that we had already done, and it was critiqued, and everyone had some input as to what they saw, they liked about it, what they didn't like about it, and I don't remember everything that was said about it. But you know, when you're among friends, you know you don't want to flatter and you don't want to be too critical. So they were very kind to me. They said, "Hey, that's really nice." That was the beginning of my transformation in understanding what realism and what abstraction is, and midpoint mimesis, the midpoint between abstraction and reality, which kind of like is a bedrock for most of the work that all of the artists have done over the years. There's another painting on the slide that is done at a later stage. Some of you may have seen this before, but when you see it, it's the next to the last one. No.
I don't have it in the same order.
It's Mimesis XX. Anyway.
This one?
Yeah. That's a painting of a horn player. Okay. You know that because you see it, right? You see someone playing saxophone or flute or... My concept of mimesis is that there is an image, but do you need all of the clues that tells you what the image is or what it is doing? Can some things be suggested, and then the viewer draws his or her own conclusion as to what it is and how they feel about it? Certainly, you know, you can respond to the colors, to the organization, to the composition. But as far as having a specific relation to it in terms of experiences, I don't think you form the conclusion until you know what the subject is for something that's abstract. If it's mimesis at midpoint, or if it's somewhere at a point between naturalism, realism, and abstraction, does this fill the bill? And I'm asking that as an open-ended question, because it's mimesis at midpoint is really something that's very open-ended. Those of you participating in the experience are looking at a more recent work. And can I hear a few of the responses? Can someone tell me quickly what they see?
Sperm chasing an egg.
Female in water.
Pardon?
I saw female in water.
Okay.
I saw planes and waves, like plane surfaces, plane.
Ocean, symphony, musical notes evaporate in the air.
Snakes.
Healthy snakes.
Snakes.
People laughing.
An explosion of vibrant color and constant motion.
Okay.
Dance and color.
Jazz.
Shall I tell you?
Please do.
About after I retired, I found it very relaxing to swim every day. I swim maybe 3/4 of a mile. That's about 40 laps in the pool. So that's me swimming.
This particular one.
Yeah. Okay. Now you probably can't tell because I don't have I'm not wearing the spandex. I can read thoughts too. I see Robert Page sitting over thinking. Now, what has that got to do about being bad and relevant? which is something that, well, we produce work during a certain age that is still very much upon us. But in many ways, we're in a different age, a new age. And a lot of the representations that we did 45 years ago are still, they're still very much alive and relevant today. But in looking forward, what will form the bedrock of a new age where the concerns today are pretty much where they were 45 years ago, but today there's certainly some added ones, and some of them have to do with health and wellness and fitness and serenity, peace of mind, higher states of consciousness, those things that are in the realm of abstraction in many ways. So this is me on the quest of trying to give visual representation of what I think is this age that we're in now. I don't want to talk too much longer. AfriCOBRA was never an event. It's a process that's going to go on and on and on. I think over 45 years from now, what will the images be like? We don't know. 10 years from now, or even 5 years from now, I think the bedrock images are still going to be there. You've seen the latest piece that I did that's downstairs, the Watch Night 150. That title is this is the 150th year of the emancipation, or the beginning of the emancipation, when Lincoln freed the captives. December 31st, 1862 was the first watch night. And most of us know from churches what a watch night is or was, where captives stayed up all night waiting for the new year, when slavery would end in those states that had seceded from the Union. That's my latest piece. So in that one, I'm incorporating all of the principles that we've worked with, and a new technique. So please take a look at it and let me know what you think.
The images I've done have all been basically in the past, and they all address the idea of functionalism. You know, what was important during that particular period of time. Most of the prints that you saw downstairs were all done during the early 70s. And I think that one of the most important starts with that Resist Law and Order in a Sick Society, which was in 1968. I started doing silk screens because I was doing basically printmaking with lithography, woodcuts, and my tools were stolen. So I started doing silk screens because it was something that I didn't need a press for. I could do it at home. And that became more relevant. But this is based on the 1968 Democratic Convention. And during that 1968 is the death of Martin Luther King and the many riots that occurred in all of the different cities around the country. And also in terms of the fact that we have Wessler, who in his medium cool thought that there was going to be a lot of unrest by us as the people during the Democratic Convention, and they had that meeting on the West Side in terms of interviewing Jeff Donaldson. Robert Page was there, and I was there among many other artists and writers and musicians that was in the room. But they have it billed as if we were black, part of the Black Panther Party, which we were not, you know. We were basically just artists and expressing our views at that particular period of time. Because of that meeting, when they started, many of the artists left town for the convention, Democratic Convention, because of the fact that the police in Chicago had a tendency to really be working on rotting up and planning for demonstrations and riots during that time. But what happened was it was not a racial protest that occurred. It was more civil and political because they were speaking about the Vietnam War rather than in terms of black civil rights at the time. But there was a lot of confrontation and protests. And I just happened to go down on 18th and Wabash during the time where they were trying to prevent a group that was marching from the stockyards down to protest. And they were corralled in the street with tanks and police and guards. And I happened to be on a building to see that here we are in America where we're supposed to be able to protest. And we are being subjugated by being surrounded. And almost in terms of the fact that they were completely limited in terms of trying to move forward. So each part of this has to deal with that in terms of be your brother's keeper, that we must be aware of that because I was dealing with messages that I wanted the viewer to take into view, and messages that had a tendency to speak about the fact that we needed to think about our society and what was happening in it. So the idea of resist law and order in a sick society became significant. And the young man that had his poetry last night, which had a great deal of resist law and order in a sick society, and I thought that was very significant. So you see components of what occurred there. So it's almost like blocking in order to see different views of what was happening at that particular period of time. The other reason that 1968 becomes important is because of that, the Olympics, in terms of the Black Power movement, and that had a tendency to be the basis of the print that many people have, which is the fact that we must unite. And this, again, is dealing with functionalism in the terms of trying to educate, address the problems that we have, and giving a time kind of solution to that problem, which was one of the, those are some of the basic philosophical concepts that we had at that particular period of time. So this becomes important, and it's also is important in terms of utilizing the elements of design, both in the last one and this, in terms of repetition and rhythm and movement and making changes within the image. The other, in terms of nation time, again, is dealing with the same idea This view would say between would be more between abstraction and realism, and just in terms of having the head symbolizing us and coming to a position to confront what is occurring or what is needed in terms of its nation time. Again, dealing with the rhythmic use of lettering and almost in terms of starting from a whisper to a shout, you know, that says has the tendency in terms of changing the letters so that they would be more dominant. But we're still dealing in many of those ideas today in terms of that which is needed because they're still trying to make changes. I think about the Prince Albert one that you did relative to the fact that there is that law that they can make a change in terms of limiting us to, in terms of confrontation. You want to speak about that, the King Alfred print that you did?
Only because you asked. just briefly, that was a real-time experience. Someone was handing out these flyers on the street. I think it was 75th and Cottage Grove. And I grabbed one and looked it over, and it had a high degree of plausibility contained in it. Possibility, yes. When you talk about containment and oppression and all those things, certainly at that time it was going through the minds of a lot of people, especially a lot of people who had time on their hands. And I don't mean that, you know, disparagingly, but I looked at it with a grain of salt, and I said, well, you know, it has happened. You know, the King Alfred plan was a supposed plan to set up concentration camps in the ghetto. And that was something that some people felt was very real. And can the government do that? Well, you know, the government is people. And whoever is controlling the government, you know, can pretty much call the terms. But anyway, that's what that the origins of that painting. I don't have anything else to say about it.
I bring garments to AfriCOBRA. I speak through my medium and take on the principles that I've embraced, that we've created, and try to give you a visual image in your wearing apparel. So, could you please do Ebony Family? This is my Ebony Family, and it was in response to our project to create a black family. I found this particularly important because of being a new wife and mother. It was very much on my mind. And was something that I wanted to voice in my garment. The times at this period were absolutely deafening with the marches, the voices on the airwaves, the newspapers that covered stories. There was turmoil. There was a need to rise and take control. There was a tendency of people apportioning their day in some for marching, some for demonstrating, some for passing out literature. But it was important to react to the times and the strife that we were enduring. And I know that once I heard some marvelous soapbox artist or speaker from that art convinced me that I ought to be down at the sit-in to fight for some cause, to march maybe tomorrow when they gather at some point. And yet I was a mother, a wife, and I was concerned, what position do you take as an artist who has chosen to be in a group that wants to address these issues? What is the most powerful thing that you can do and give? And I spoke with Wadsworth, and young Wadsworth Jr. was, you know, sort of crawling around. And I made a pitch then that the thing that we can do and do best is take care of business at home, to protect our young, to teach, to make aware conditions that we face, but that I thought that down the line, it may take a while, but down the line, the largest contribution that, or first and foremost in our minds, is to raise a good family. Because if you have a whole and strong family, that's what you bring to your community. And it's not instantaneous reaction, but it's building something powerful and something for our people, so that when those youngsters go out and carry their banners, they've had the experience of a holistic family, have a consideration for neighbors and friends. These are simplistic stuff, but so are the ABCs. You know, it's just, you got to start somewhere. And 46 years has gone by now, and they're pretty cool. They're, you know, and they have taken our teachings out, and we continue to speak, but it's important to teach our community the importance of family. And so that's where I made my commitment in AfriCOBRA. Thereafter, I get a little bit rough and tough, but my first voice was to give, and we, one of our principles was to make our work look like posters, you know, so giving a message. So this posterish kind of approach to the Ebony family was important to me. And it's as close to a daishiki as I've done. But it lent to the flat, the flat kind of surface, and something that I could border and bring your attention to center, to know the importance of your gestures, your touching, your protecting, your arm around, protect the head of the baby, and that youngster in the foreground, is this foreground when it's down? But he knows to be comforting to his mother. So they have a gesture that is a sort of language, I'm here for you kind of thing. So that was my interest in this. But I got a little bit more reflective of the times. That piece is in the, it's downstairs. And these, I do suits and coats a lot. So this particular suit was to arrange the brothers in the skirt panels to arms interlinked to surround sis. The idea is often surmised that it's to protect her. But I sort of think since sis is higher up than the brothers, it's to raise her. Okay? So elevate sis. She's important, and make her know she's important. So it isn't, excuse the expression, just badassness and, and interlocking your arms to protect her from harm. There's some good in everything, you know? So I am the youngest in a family of five that had three big brothers. One 5 years older, one 11 years older, and one 12 years older. Mm-hmm. Those are big guys. And you can imagine how spoiled this little girl was. But they were father-like figures. And let me diverse just a little more. That dad, who was a chauffeur for a very wealthy banker, some type, really was on the fly from the crash of the late 20s. And so dad drove him from place to place all over the country. So he was gone long periods. And that was during a period where the boys were growing up and they had sort of one another, but they didn't have a lot of one-on-one with dad. Just daily one-on-one. They had special interests and that they did things together. But when my father no longer had that job and was working in town, I became the little guy that he didn't get the chance to take fishing, teach how to use a saw, a hammer. I could wield a hammer. And I became his dude, his little dude. And he was so proud of everything I made, you know. And so I had dad and those three brothers. I had a sister. She was 8 years older, and that's a space that's very difficult, a gap to close. But we were girlies together. We always had the same room together. But to let you know how folks naturally choose a path, I just say to him, she's an AKA and I'm a Delta. So, hey. But that's choice, you know. But nonetheless, I really embraced these guys. These guys always, you know, taught me what they knew, just gave me advice. First pair of high heel shoes, Brother Bobby said, I don't think so. I think those are too high. You know? And I would like to see you in a lower upper pump. And I did so. You know? But there's some I've always had family interaction, and that's what I carry to my work. There's a vein of that always sort of in of the importance of that, even in the revolution. When we do the revolutionary suit, and that's the last that I will tie you up, that I can hang in the revolution.
The first time I even heard about doing a movement. This was way before we was black. We were still Negroes then. This was like back in 1963. And we was in a small art fair up at 55th and Lake Park, where the co-op is. And it was about six or seven artists in the show, and Jeff was there. And Jeff got up, and Jeff's got a huge vocabulary. He's a tall guy, 6 feet six, and about 200 pounds. And he's got a large vocabulary and a big mouth to deliver it. Yeah. So, and it intimidated most people. Just looking at him, you know, his height, but once he's, you know, he got this big voice. But anyway, he mentioned about starting a Negro artist movement. And, you know, during this time, Jeff included, I and most of the artists I knew, we artists were basically lonely. And to join a group is something different, you know. To back up a little, what we did at the Wall of Respect, the first meeting I went to, they had had a couple of meetings before I went to the meeting, before I went to any meeting. And I was told to bring a piece of work. So everybody put their work around the wall to see if what we had in common that was ethnically in common in our work. So probably not that much at that time. Like I said, we were still Negroes then, and we hadn't the real explosion of the black movement hadn't started, and Malcolm X was still living. And so to talk about Malcolm, when he got assassinated, this kicked off the black artist movement, especially in Chicago. And possibly in other cities too. So this was 68 when we met at my studio for the first meeting. So we brought work similar to what we did in at the first Wall of Respect meeting, and we put our stuff around the wall. And again, I'm not sure that was any much that much relationship in the art, because you know. That related to each other, except for some things. One thing was in common, we saw that we broke up spaces. We broke up large areas in the painting. We broke up those spaces into small areas. You know, this was one common thing we had going, which made the paintings and the work very active. Even Jay had a garment. She brought a patchwork garment that had the same kind of rhythmic pattern that will broken up small space will do to a painting though. So we started talking about, we made principles which formed the whole philosophy, and each principle was like a plank and a platform, and together they made a philosophy, you know. So, and we talked about this for eons, over and over and over, and we talked about in and everything, you know, what was going on. We was aware of all of the, what was going on presently with all of the turmoil and stuff. So then we started adopting principles, I mean, devising principles that was our own. And what this principle does is make this philosophy that no one can read anything into our art. It's, and we had had that travel with even the first exhibit we had, you know. We made the philosophy. So we really didn't have to explain anything to anybody. And I noticed Jeff and I was both the only two people from the South that was in the first meeting. Gerald is from Chicago, Barbara is from Chicago, and Jay is from Cleveland, Ohio. And Jeff is from Arkansas, and I'm from Georgia. So we had a lot in common in terms of knowing segregation and
racism, whether it was we experienced it or either if it was vicarious.
Wadsworth, I'm from Houston, Texas.
But you wasn't in the first meeting.
No, no.
That's you're right. I'm talking you're about right. the Just first.
In the oh, in the first meeting.
I'm talking about the first
okay.
founding people.
Okay. Sorry.
And so Jeff and I understood the racism, internalized it probably more than the other three people. And anyway, so we talked, and the form, the philosophy was to deal with the problems that was current, not just our black community, just for black people. Not even at first in America, but for everywhere black people live, they had a problem. And even in where there was the majority, like South Africa, they are a majority there. And I never figured out how they can do this, but they did it. I don't see how you can be the majority and ruling, you know. But I know how they did it. But anyway, getting back to Africa. We wanted to make statements and stuff relevant to what we were doing. So the first painting that we decided to make was a group project. It's called Black Family. And why we did it was because of the all of the negativism that's surrounding black men. And so we decided to make a strong black family because, you know, all of the stuff is written about, you know, a lot of black families are split and they're just brought up by mothers. So we wanted to show a strong family with a father and a wife and you know, at least one child. So this started, but this is when we had not reached the black aesthetic. This is still based in European aesthetics. All of this, you know, it's just the only thing makes the difference in here is the lettering. The B's, black is beautiful, is where it came from. But otherwise, if I take that away, it's just, well, even with it, it's just a European painting. You know, I was trained, we all had formal training at our institute and different institutions. So, and we had all internalized, we knew about all of the movements in art, white movements, we knew about the impressionists and anybody you name. So anyway, we hadn't reached the black aesthetic on this painting. And but this is what the painting was, to give some positive, to talk positively about a black family. This is constructed, this is completely constructed out of words and letters. And again, the B became, to me, was my way of doing it. And each person was, although it was in the group, each person still was an individual. And you express your way, but as long as some of it coincided with the principles we had in the group. It didn't have to be all of the principles, just related to some of it. And this particular painting was, the girl in the middle, I had a commission to do a watercolor of her for Anna Kohlheim, who's the principal of Hyde Park High, which participated in a program called Woodlawn Experimental Schools Project. It was a project that was part of the University of Chicago and a middle school and a high school. And anyway, she commissioned me to do a portrait of the girl in the middle. I did a watercolor. And the two girls on the end, I met when we moved up to Boston. And they let me take photographs of them. You know, we had ice cream together. And when I got down, I took a job down when we moved down to Washington, D.C., I was beginning to teach at Howard. And I made the painting out of when I moved down to Georgia. But the aesthetics here is moving into constructing a black aesthetic. I'm able to be a poet, I'm able to be an artist, I'm able to be a lot of things. This is what the lettering allowed for me, just unfettered words, things that I can use. I can say anything I want in here. And it's got a lot of things in there that sometimes you might not ever see them. And it's got words in there that offend some people, you know. Anybody, any race of people might see it because they would call them, not dirty words, what kind of words?
Curse words,
sort of.
Profanity.
Four-letter words. This would offend some people, you know. But this is my beginning of my idea of moving away from European aesthetics to an aesthetic that we are going to create, which would be an African-American aesthetic. Okay, can I see another one? Yeah, this one is of the Black Panthers. And these are real revolutionary figures. And when we moved up to Boston, Bobby Seale was on trial for the murder of a guy named Rackley that they thought was informal infiltrated the Panthers. And so anyway, he was killed and Bobby was on trial for his murder. And I was working in Cambridge in a commercial art place. And you passed a newsstand and all of these books on the Panthers and posters everywhere about the trial. And I got interested in it and I was reading it. But we was already interested in the Panthers because of Huey Newton. You know, we familiar with the Panthers, and we knew a lot of literature about them. But anyway, they had all of these books and things, and I bought a couple of books, and then I started, all of my artwork was in, when we moved up to Boston, to back up just a little, Jay and I moved from Chicago, and we didn't really know where it was going. And most people don't do that unless you're crazy. People, you don't move anywhere, you don't know where you're going. You know, with two kids on top of that, you know. You know, because my sisters just thought I was crazy, you know. And Nelson asked me that, Nelson Stevens in the group, he thought I was crazy. How are you going to make a living? And I said, with my art. And he laughed. So anyway, she picked out a place where we would be close to New York. We didn't want to move to New York City because we had two kids, and we didn't think that was be too cool to move there. So she picked out Waterbury, Connecticut, which was a couple of hours out of New York by train or by car. So and we shipped all our belongings before we left for it, and when we moved there, her and Jennifer, my middle daughter, left for, they went ahead of us. And Jerry and I, my son, Wadsworth Jr., stayed behind. I had some business to take care of in Chicago. So I went in at night, and the next morning we got up, and I went out, and this is the first time I've seen homeless people sleeping in the city square. Because when I left Chicago, you had Skid Row on Madison Avenue, but that's, you know, we call them bums. These are people that, some people thought they made a choice to be there. But these people were homeless, they were sleeping on cardboard boxes out in the city square, and buildings all boarded up. And I told her that I'm not gonna let the sun set on me here, set on us in this city. So we caught a cab to New Haven, which was something like 24 miles away. And we stayed there a minute, and then we went up to Boston, and this is when I took a job in a commercial art firm. This, you know, and I was working in Cambridge, as I was mentioning, and saw all of this stuff. And this is how this painting was created. And I had all of our art materials and everything was in storage. So I got some craft paper from the studio I was working in and started making sketches. Mainly the first two of Bobby Seale and Huey Newton. And later I added the other Panthers. My tenure with it was 29 years, and that's a long time. And even though I resigned in 29 because I thought my work was different, going in another direction, and this is what I said to them, And also, it was hard for me to wanting to do something else that to be harnessed in the same direction. As an artist, I thought I needed to grow in a different direction. But I've mentioned this before. Once you was a member of AfriCOBRA, you was a lifetime member, because it was almost like, and for a better word, I use an indoctrination almost, philosophy. It was so infectious, you know, you can't ever get rid of it. Because my first show I had was mostly, the work was the last abstract work I had called In 201. And the lady wrote it up from the newspaper in Atlanta, Georgia. She had written a lot of things about me before when I lived there. And she looked at the work, what she said, you can tell it's his work. But it was still the AfriCOBRA influence was still in the work, even though I was trying to be Wadsworth Gerald, you know. So, but it's an influence that will go on and on. The work will always be current. The first art we made will always be current. And it will never die.
Group identity was not an essential aspect of my modus operandi for functioning, you know, and this is steeped out of my upbringing in my family. But in high school, and one or two of my brothers might be here, graduated from George Washington Carver High School, which is, for me, is very, very interesting, because the most important interesting aspect of it, one of the most important interesting aspects of it, is that Barbara Jones was an art teacher there at one point in time and taught he's the fourth in the family, but he's my third brother. I'm the first in the family. We had a club in high school called the Phi Theta Kappas. Now, did we in high school and Hockey Guards know what the hell Phi Theta necessarily meant? Yes, we did, you know, as strange as it may sound. We were a part of an affiliation in Chicago called the Chicago Social Clubs. And there were clubs that lived down in the city, as they would call it now. But we associated ourselves because in the school, we had teachers who, for the most part, it was a very small high school, grammar school, I think it was a total of 500 students. But we moved to Orchard Garden in 1955. And I lived there until I graduated from high school in 62. But in Carver High School, we had the privilege of having teachers. Most of them were black teachers. Many of them had come from the South. Many of them were very active politically, culturally, and otherwise, and took a very strong interest in all of us as students. They were a part of that community. And whatever you might have done in school before you got home, it was there as well as your teacher. And that group came together as from the impetus of our English teachers, Thomas Smith, and other teachers, and particularly our art teacher, Helen Joyner, who was a young sister who had graduated from University of Arkansas in Pine Bluff. And she had come to Chicago, and I say in a very important and significant way, is that the wonderful white art teacher we had at the beginning of my high school years at George Washington Carver High taught us quite a lot. She might have been in her 80s at that time. She was a wonderful woman, a wonderful person, but she passed away. And as a result, Helen Joyner, who had just come to Chicago to also attend IIT to get a degree in textile weaving, took the position there. And that was the turning point for me as a visual image maker, was my experience with Helen Joyner, which she was pivotal in my life in high school and my development and expansion of my concept of making images in the sense that textiles was a relevant and important medium, as well as painting and sculpture and drawing and all the other aspects of artistic creation. I won a scholarship to the Art Institute of Chicago on Saturdays as a young kid. Had a lot of fun doing that. And that was the result of Helen Joyner. In 62, I graduated from George Washington High School. I had the opportunity to go to Europe to spend a summer in a joint program at the Sorbonne and the American Artists and Student Center in Paris, France. And as my uncle said when I came back, because when I returned in 62, I had an afro. But that was due to the fact that they didn't cut colored people's hair in France. Moreover, I didn't have any money to spend on that anyway. I had the few nickels and dimes I had. I got there because of a scholarship. I was attending South Shore Junior College, and I was the only black student in my art class, and the opportunity arose, and the instructor put it out to the class, and of course, many other students raised their hands, and I didn't. But the second class meeting, he asked me why I had not, and he said, look, you're the best student I have in the class, and as a matter of fact, if you'd like to go, I'll help you get a scholarship. So off to Europe I went. And as my uncle Skeet said, I haven't been the same ever since. I came back with afro, and before I left for Europe, I was also working at Jewel Tea Company. I was working at Mr. Young's barbershop on 71st. And I used to shine shoes, and made a hell of a lot of money shining shoes. And I always had to keep my own shoes shine. That was a part of the growing up in my family. You had to keep your attire, you know, in top-notch order. And that's boded me well in terms of my life as a person and in the aspect of looking at AfriCOBRA. And all of that sort of spins me along the arc of AfriCOBRA, the context of not being so much about being in a group. But the group had to have some purpose and reason for being other than just simply, you know, getting together and hanging around or something of that nature. We had great involvement in drama and theater and writing and the arts at Carver High School, and leaving there, continuing the fellowship with those faculty that I had in high school with Helen Joyner. I babysitted her children while she was at the IIT, taking her classes. And her encouragement for me to go on to the Art Institute of Chicago, which I won a scholarship out of high school there, but I just, after going to Europe, I was hell-bent on being an artiste. Mm-hmm. Going back to Paris, going back to Europe, I was enjoying the rest of the, quote, expatriates. But interestingly enough, when I left and went there, I took with me a book to read, James Baldwin's Another Country. And that experience in Europe with Africans from all over the planet, Europeans from all over the planet, coming back to the United States and having the opportunity to be simultaneously, but on the other side of the planet, participate in the March on Washington, where they had a support march for the March on Washington in Paris of internationals on the same day that the March on Washington occurred here in the United States. I was, beatniking, bohemian around from about 1962 until 1965, when I finally decided I was gonna take up the opportunity of my scholarship at the Art Institute of Chicago and actually go get a BFA. And I was active as a student and involved in the larger community, because I say growing up in Chicago, in black Chicago, you have to opt out of being an activist. That's just the way you brought up to be an activist. If anyone is not an activist, then you make a decision not to be. And meeting Jeff and Wadsworth and Barbara and Jay and all of them was a very pivotal point for me in the sense of looking at art making as a vehicle for change. The principles and philosophy, the aesthetic grounding that we established as AfriCOBRA. And it's very significant what Wadsworth, his somewhat closing remark was that, as I say it, from what we say as growing up in Alvia Gardens, once from the gardens, always from the gardens, once an AfriCOBRA, always an AfriCOBRA. You know, you never not become who you are. And so AfriCOBRA, the principles we set forward are have been worked on for 45 nearly years, but I would say 45 plus, because we were unconsciously working on those principles and aesthetics before we became a group. And when we became a group, we became a family. And as a family, we have continued this journey together. And when I say together, I don't mean in the sense of being shoulder to shoulder as we are here, but together in the sense of spirit, in the sense of purpose, and in the sense of knowing that what we started to do and continue to do was about projecting, as we stated, positive images and creating work that would move people forward. And not only was it about moving people forward, it moved us forward. Because had we not coalesced in the sense of having a spiritual and familial connection one to the other, and by extension, many other brothers and sisters here in Chicago who are also artists, some are still with us and others not, were all a part of AfriCOBRA in one kind of way or another through their relationship and friendships with us, our relationships and friendships with them, and our continual involvement with the larger community. And the principles and aesthetics that we formalized, and I say that very seriously, formalized, because when contrary to or and in no way oppositional, AfriCOBRA's position about what we do with work is not oppositional. It's intentional. And there's a difference between being oppositional and being intentional. Intentional is premised on approaching whatever it is you are approaching from the position of being of it, as opposed to being outside of it. And so the principles that we've been dealing with in terms of color and shine and mimic at midpoint and frontality and Kool-Aid colors and all those other various aspects of the ingredients that make up our work, we have over 45 years made that a formal manner of producing visual images. No less important than the formal manners of producing visual images that are continually taught in schools today. And trust me, over these 45 years, with all of us sitting up here, we have all taught thousands of students the formal aspects of AfriCOBRA principles and aesthetics. We see it resonating in works all over this country. And we take great pride in the fact that, as I think it was Jay said, or Wadsworth, whomever, I'm having one of Richard Pryor's moments. You know, sometimes I do and sometimes I don't remember. But it's like the old spiritually, you know, I may not come when you call me, but I'm always on time. And so seeing the show mounted downstairs was very much a return to the Studio Museum in Harlem, which was on 5th Avenue, just off 125th Street in Harlem. And little did we know in, what was that, 1970?
Yeah, 70.
We were actually having our first exhibit in what they would call the big time avenue in New York for art galleries, 5th Avenue. But we were uptown. And it's been a wonderful journey, which is not over till I no longer have breath, that AfriCOBRA has been a way in which, and I think I would speak for everybody here and those of AfriCOBRA who are not here, a way of living. A way of living. It has not been a group in as much as it's been a family, because we would meet at Wadsworth Studio. We'd eat, we'd change or see being changed baby diapers and all kinds of other stuff. And some of us who didn't have children at the time, we learned quite a bit about how to be a couple, how to be a family. And the aspect of having, if you will, assignments, as Nelson likes to call them. We had assignments, bodies of work that we created. The Soweto piece, body of work, the Black Family, Black Woman, and we, Nation Time. And the significance of AfriCOBRA's philosophy of demystifying the aspect of what, quote, fine art is or is not, was taken up by AfriCOBRA as well as the larger community in Chicago. AfriCOBRA is the concept which came from, I would say, not so much from our collective minds, but from the larger community, because as we began to articulate our principles and our aesthetic grounding, they were based in many of our conversations and observations about what we saw in our community. Of all of the members of AfriCOBRA, I think Barbara has imbued all of us with a sense of the power of graphic imagery in a way that has consciously and unconsciously come forward in all of our work. And this piece here is my homage to Barbara. Mm-hmm. You didn't know that, did you?
No, I didn't.
Well, I needed to wait till an appropriate time. And since I left Chicago, 37 years ago, I thought it'd be time to tell you that now. And, so that's all I have to say at the moment.
I have to first apologize to Wadsworth for interrupting him in his talk, so full of history and content, but I couldn't sit here because I am certainly from the South, from Houston, Texas. And I did go to, of course, high school and college at the University of Texas. And after that, I came to the area. I went back and forth from Gary, Indiana, where I taught, and I would come over to Chicago on the weekends. And after marrying, I moved here. And I have been a Chicagoan ever since. It's so interesting the way paths cross. I did know that Helen Joyner had a great influence over you. She talked about you with me, but we had never met, you know. And she certainly had a great influence over my teaching career. And she was a mentor for me in the Chicago public school system. But I don't know of many things that were more exciting and dynamic than my joining AfriCOBRA and being not exposed to some areas, a lot of Chicago. I don't think there are words to describe the energy that I felt working on the wall of respect with Bill Walker. And it was just a learning experience just to be in his company and to work with him. It was toward the end that I was pulled into that project. And so Jeff said, well, there's not much more she can do. She's worked with Bill. Take that newspaper stand over there. Let her work on that and finish that. And I did. And I just enjoyed. I mean, I had no apprehensions about coming out there at night and painting on that newspaper stand. And the man selling the papers was so kind and so nice. He was just like an uncle. And but that led me right into joining AfriCOBRA. I just thought it was wonderful that as a group, we had our themes and we had our ideas that we would work paintings around. And there's nothing better than pulling out the individualism of an artist than giving them a common theme. And you would think that it would do the opposite, but even with a theme, everyone's approach, their visual image was different, and the way they adapted or used those principles always had a unique twist to it. And I saw that and appreciated that. I like the idea that it was stated that the principles make a platform. And I certainly felt that a structure, I have a great deal of respect for structure, and it helped me in my development of my artwork to have structure to work from. I have the greatest respect, and one of the thrills is working with everybody in the group. It's hard to put into words what you learn from life by seeing people who are creative and attack the challenges of life. I mean, just we're talking about just everyday living, having children, and figuring out how to rear them and how to love them and how to encourage them, and being in contact with people who have no children and who are not married, and who you learn to encourage each other through whatever it is you are going through. And even with your disagreements, there is, as Napoleon said, a spirituality that exists in the group. And I appreciated that no matter where we were living, different parts of the country, that spirituality certainly did and does continue to exist. I don't know that I have that much more to say. Produced a lot of work in recent years, but I know I'm going to go back to working because I know that art, being an artist, is at the core of my very being. It is my purpose for being alive, and sharing that creativity is my gift to the world, and so I have no doubt that even at this stage of my life, after teaching and not having time for this and not having time for that, that I will return to doing exactly that again.